Okay, so we have here the functions of various parts of the respiratory system. Okay, so we will actually go into the various parts and try and understand what are their basic functions. So the nasal cavity, basically the nasal cavity here, see, here is the nostril and here is the nasal cavity. In the earlier slide we have seen that the nasal cavity can actually be divided into three parts. And the basic function of the nasal cavity is to free the air from any kind of dust particles and bacteria and all. And it also regulates the temperature of the air before it enters the lungs or the alveoli. Okay. So the nasal cavity is actually located at the back of the nostrils, just above the buccal cavity. So above the buccal cavity, we have the nasal cavity. What are the importance and functions? Has special nasal epithelium by which air is filtered by hairs. So the air is filtered by the hairs, moistened by mucus. Why is air filtered by hairs? So that it becomes free of the dust particles, the hair that we have in our nostrils, moistened by mucus to cool down the temperature if the air is happened, if the air is having a higher temperature, it might damage the alveoli when it enters the lungs, and warmed by capillary network. Now, if the air is too cool, then also it might have a damaging effect on the alveoli. So it needs to be warmed by a capillary network before it enters the lungs. So it needs to be warmed by a capillary network of blood cells. So this blood supply basically increases the temperature before it enters the lungs. Mucus, the additional function of mucus, apart from cooling the air that enters the lungs, is to trap the dust and other fine particles. And also we know that there are olfactory cells which will detect the smell of the air. Okay, then we have nasopharynx. Nasopharynx is the upper part of the pharynx. So if you look into this, the upper part of the pharynx, air enters the nasopharynx through two internal openings. The air is free from dust particles, is moist and warm. When the air enters the nasopharynx, it is already free from the dust particles and is moist and warm. Okay, so we'll look into more features of the respiratory system so that we have a better idea about how it actually works in synchrony. Okay, so we have some more features out here of the respiratory system. Functions of various parts of the respiratory system, as we were learning. So parts, let's say we have oropharynx. So this is basically the nasal system, the nasal cavity, and this is the oropharynx. Oropharynx is basically located behind the buccal cavity, and then we have the laryngopharynx. Okay, so this is basically the laryngopharynx. So oropharynx and laryngopharynx, the laryngopharynx part is behind larynx. After nasopharynx, air passes through oropharynx and laryngopharynx to enter the larynx or the voice box. Okay, so this is basically a channel. Once it enters the larynx, also known as the voice box, okay, so there is a cartilaginous structure at the opening of trachea. This is basically a cartilaginous structure at the opening of the trachea. So it has fibroelastic ligaments. There are fibroelastic ligaments called vocal cords through which sound is produced basically when we speak. So these vocal cords are of different lengths in males and females. Hence the voice that is produced is different. Okay, so we have vocal cords. Different sounds can be produced by varying the tension of the vocal cords. Okay, then we have the glottis. We have the glottis, which is basically a slit line opening to the larynx. So this is basically a slit line opening to the larynx and a narrow slit like opening of the larynx through which air passes into trachea via the larynx. So this is a basically narrow slit like opening of the larynx through which air passes into trachea via the larynx. So now the air will basically enter the trachea. Okay, so we will have the functions of the various parts of the respiratory system as we were doing it. So we will now move on to, is this visible? Let me just check here. Now this is a little visible. Okay, so we have the epiglottis part. Epiglottis is what? A triangular flap of cartilage present at the glottis. So it is basically a triangular flap of cartilage tissues present at the glottis. Since pharynx, basically what happens is the pharynx is the common passage for both food and air. So epiglottis closes the opening of the larynx during swallowing. Otherwise, what will happen is the food will enter the nasal chamber, the food will enter the pharynx, and it will cause choking. Okay, so hence it is always advisable not to speak while you are eating, because at the time of eating the epiglottis closes the opening of the larynx so that the food is not passing into the voice box and choking us during swallowing. So it is a basically reflex action that prevents food to enter the trachea. So food, if it enters the trachea, it might cause many problems including choking, especially in children it might even lead to death. Okay, so choking is something that actually can cause a huge harm, so we should be a little careful about speaking when we are having food. Okay, so now we have the trachea. A lot of things have to be remembered about trachea. So runs through the neck in front of the oesophagus and extends into the thoracic cavity. So it extends into the thoracic cavity. So what does it do? It functions and its importance: connects lungs to lesopharynx, and about 12 cm in length and 2.5 cm in diameter, has C-shaped rings of cartilage. So these are basically C-shaped rings of cartilage that prevent the collapse of the trachea during inspiration. So during inspiration, air is going in, so hence it opens up and then it closes, opens up and then it closes. Okay, so it has C-shaped rings of cartilage that prevent the collapse of the trachea during inspiration. Inspiration means inhaling. Opening part of C is towards the oesophagus. So the opening part of C is towards the oesophagus. So this is lined with ciliated pseudo stratified columnar epithelium. Very important. Okay, ciliated pseudo stratified columnar epithelium that keeps the unwanted particles away from the lungs. So this basically keeps the unwanted particles like dust, bacteria, etc. from the lungs. The mucus, which is secreted by globate glands of the epithelium, traps dust particles and microbes. So this epithelium basically secretes mucus which traps the dust particles and microbes. It divides into two bronchi as it enters the thoracic cavity. So obviously before entering the thoracic cavity, it divides into two bronchi. So from the fifth thoracic cavity, each bronchus has rings at cartilage. So each of these bronchi has rings at the cartilage. Okay. Okay, so we will now come into the structure of the lungs. Okay, so we all know that the trachea, which is basically the pipe that we have considered, divides into two bronchi, and each of these two bronchi goes into the two lungs. Whenever we are drawing any human structure, we have to understand that we have to place ourselves in the paper like this. So this is basically the lungs part. Okay, so obviously this will be the left lung and this will be the right lung. Okay, we always, whether it is the heart, whether it is the kidneys, whether it is the respiratory system, we always have to place ourselves on the paper like this. Okay, so the front part is on the paper. So this part as it is will be the right part and this part will be the left part. We will not draw it in this way. Okay, so it is always as if the human structure is coming out of the paper. Okay, so this is basically the right lung and this is the left lung and this will be the right lung. There are minute differences between the two in terms of size and weight, and there's a depression as well and lobes as well. Okay, so the trachea actually enters, or the bronchia actually enters, through an opening which is known as the hilum in both the lungs. Okay, so right bronchus is wider and more, see if you look into it, the right bronchus is wider and more horizontal. The left bronchus will be narrower and more vertical. Okay, so the right bronchi will be wider and more of a horizontal type. The left bronchi will be narrower and it will be more vertical. Okay, now these two lungs have some differences. We will see here that the lungs actually have, the right lung actually has three lobes. Okay, the first one is known as the superior lobe. The second one is known as the middle lobe. This is the middle lobe, and the last one is known as the inferior lobe. Whereas if we look into the left lung, it is just divided into two lobes. So here we have this lobe, So here we have, this is not a lobe, basically this is the general labeling of the diagram. There is a depression here which is represented by this. Okay, so this is basically divided into two. So this is basically the superior lobe and this is the inferior lobe. So the right lung, basically if we, the bronchi enters the two lungs by the means of hilum, the right lung is bigger in size, the left lung is a little smaller in size. The right lung is again divided into three lobes, superior, middle and inferior, and the left lung is divided into two lobes, superior and inferior. This is bigger, this lung is basically bigger and is heavier, basically 620 grams, and this lung is smaller and it is lighter as well, which is basically 560 grams. Okay, if you look into this, there is a slight depression in the left lung, and this is basically known as the cardiac notch. The heart is basically adjusted in this. We all know that the heart is little, so the heart is adjusted in this depression. So there is a depression, slight depression, which is known as the cardiac knob, which is present in the left lung. No such depression is present in the right lung. Okay, now we'll talk about the membranes here. So we have the membranes here. This is basically, this is known as the visceral pleura. See, this is basically the pleural membrane. This is a double layered membrane. This is a double layered membrane. It is also known as pleural membrane. Okay, so in between is fluid, the pleural fluid. Okay, so this pleural fluid acts as a lubricant, see, in between the two membranes. One is the visceral pleural, which is the inside membrane. Okay, so and there is pleural fluid which is filled in between. So this fluid acts as a lubricant. So see, one is known as the outer membrane of this pleural membrane is known as parenteral pleura, and the inner membrane is known as visceral pleura. So the outer membrane is known as parenteral pleura and the inner membrane is known as the visceral pleura. In between is filled the pleural fluid. Now what is the function of this pleural fluid? It acts as a lubricant, obviously. It protects the lungs from mechanical shocks. So whatever mechanical shocks the lungs might get, these are sophisticated organisms, organs, and it protects the lungs from mechanical shocks. And it also holds the two membranes together, the visceral and the pleural, it holds the two membranes together. Okay, so this is how the lungs would look like. This is how the entire structure would look like. Okay, and these are the basic differences which are there between the two lungs. Slightly heavier, slightly there's a depression which is there, and there are three lobes in here, there are only two lobes out here. Okay. Okay, so some more parts about the structure of the lungs. So we have here the trachea, which basically divides into two bronchi. So the trachea basically divides into two bronchi, one going into the right lung and the other one into the left lung, which we have already seen. Now, as we have seen, in the right lung we have three lobes. So this bronchi has to go into the three lobes, so it divides into three. Okay, and again, this bronchi, since there are two lobes in the left lung, so it will basically divide into two. So bronchi is basically the first part, and it's known as the primary bronchus. So this is the primary bronchus, which divides into three branches, which divides into three branches, one going, so this is basically the primary bronchus. Okay, this is the primary bronchus, this is the primary bronchus, which is dividing. As it goes into the right lung, it divides into three branches, one going into each lobe, and into the left lung it divides into two branches. It divides into basically two branches. So this is how it is. So primary bronchi basically are two. This is the primary bronchi, which is two. Secondary bronchi, if we look into it, so this is the secondary bronchi. So it is three in the right lung as per the number of lobes, and two in the left lung as per the number of lobes. Now again, this will divide into tertiary bronchi. So this is going to divide more and more. This is going to divide more and more. This is also going to divide. This is also going to divide, and there will be more divisions. So if we look into the tertiary bronchi, the tertiary bronchi are 10 in number in the right lung and 8 in number in the left lung. So this is going to divide more and more. So the tertiary bronchi are 10 in number in the right lung and 8 in number in the left lung. So first branch is known as the primary bronchus, the first branch. The second branch is known as the secondary bronchus, which basically is 3 in the right lung and 2 in the left lung as per the number of lobes. Further branching, this is known as the tertiary bronchus. Okay, so further branching is known as the tertiary bronchus. We have this muscular region as well, which is known as the diaphragm, that is the membrane of the muscular region. The middle part is known, the middle part of this entire thing is known as mediastina, and the entire thing is, the entire lungs structure is in the thoracic cavity. So the entire thing is in the thoracic cavity. So this was a basic outline of the lungs, how they look like. Okay, so some more parts about the structure of the lungs. So we have here the trachea, which basically divides into two bronchi. So the trachea basically divides into two bronchi, one going into the right lung and the other one into the left lung, which we have already seen. Now, as we have seen, in the right lung we have three lobes. So this bronchi has to go into the three lobes, so it divides into three. Okay, and again, this bronchi, since there are two lobes in the left lung, so it will basically divide into two. So bronchi is basically the first part, and it's known as the primary bronchus. So this is the primary bronchus, which divides into three branches, which divides into three branches, one going, so this is basically the primary bronchus. Okay, this is the primary bronchus, this is the primary bronchus, which is dividing. As it goes into the right lung, it divides into three branches, one going into each lobe, and into the left lung it divides into two branches. It divides into basically two branches. So this is how it is. So primary bronchi basically are two. This is the primary bronchi, which is two. Secondary bronchi, if we look into it, so this is the secondary bronchi. So it is three in the right lung, three in the right lung as per the number of lobes, and two in the left lung as per the number of lobes. Now again, this will divide into tertiary bronchi. So this is going to divide more and more. This is going to divide more and more. This is also going to divide. This is also going to divide, and there will be more divisions. So if we look into the tertiary bronchi, the tertiary bronchi are 10 in number in the right lung and 8 in number in the left lung. So this is going to divide more and more. So the tertiary bronchi are 10 in number in the right lung and 8 in number in the left lung. So first branch is known as the primary bronchus, the first branch. The second branch is known as the secondary bronchus, which basically is 3 in the right lung and 2 in the left lung as per the number of lobes. Further branching, this is known as the tertiary bronchus. Okay, so further branching is known as the tertiary bronchus. We have this muscular region as well, which is known as the diaphragm, that is the membrane of the muscular region. The middle part is known, the middle part of this entire thing is known as mediastina, and the entire thing is, the entire lungs structure is in the thoracic cavity. So the entire thing is in the thoracic cavity. So this was a basic outline of the lungs, how they look like. Okay, so we will now talk about, just one moment here. Okay, so we are now going to talk about the how the branching happens. So this is known basically the bronchial intercom. So just as in buildings we have intercom, so the entire main line divides into different branches. So this is how the bronchial intercom will look like. So here we have the trachea, which divides into two. The trachea basically, so network of branching and rebranching of primary bronchus. So the primary bronchus basically, so the trachea divides into the primary bronchus. If you look, we have studied earlier that the trachea divides into the primary bronchus, and then it divides into the secondary bronchus. Okay, and the secondary bronchus are different in the right and the left lungs. In right lung we have three lobes, so the secondary bronchus will be three in number. In the left lung we have two lobes, so the secondary bronchus will be two in number. Okay, we are just taking any random lung out here. Then it divides into the tertiary bronchus. The secondary bronchus divides into the tertiary bronchus. Now the important thing out here is that in each of these divisions we have these cartilaginous tissues. Okay, so there is cartilaginous here. Up to this level, we have the cartilaginous rings. So right from the trachea to the primary bronchus to the secondary bronchus and to the tertiary bronchus, we will have the cartilaginous rings. Okay, but from there, these are cartilaginous rings which are continuing till the tertiary bronchus. Now these divide into bronchioles. So the tertiary passage or the tertiary bronchus now divides into bronchioles, and in bronchioles we do not have cartilaginous rings. So this is basically the widest passage which does not have cartilaginous rings. Okay, so trachea, cartilaginous rings, primary bronchus, cartilaginous rings, secondary bronchus, cartilaginous rings are present, tertiary bronchus, cartilaginous rings are present. However, when it further divides into bronchioles, the cartilaginous rings are not present. So in the entire system, the bronchioles are the widest passage in which the cartilaginous rings are not present. Okay, they are about 1 millimeter in diameter. Then we have the terminal bronchi. Terminal bronchi means this will be basically the part which will be opening into the alveolar duct. We know that we have alveoli. This opens into the alveolar sac. So this is basically how an alveolar sac will look like. Okay, so each alveolar sac will have approximately 8 to 10 alveoli. Okay, so this also will divide, this also will divide. We have just shown one out here. Okay, so this alveolar sac, each alveolar sac has a diameter of approximately 0.5 millimeter. This is approximate diameter. So the network of branching and rebranching of primary bronchus is represented here. The alveoli basically is lined with mucus and it is moist. So as we can recall, in any respiratory surface, there has to be, it has to be moist. It has to be a large surface area. Of course, we have studied that as compared to earthworm, the human alveoli or even the skin, as compared to the skin, the human alveoli has a much larger surface area. It is about 50 times more. Okay, so the alveoli lined with mucus, it makes it moist, and there is also pigment which is present. This is a surfactant. This is known as lysine, and this reduces the surface tension so that the alveoli don't collapse. So lysine, this, it does what? It is a surfactant. It reduces the surface tension so that the alveoli doesn't collapse. See, surface tension is basically a phenomena in which a liquid has some tension in it. For example, during the monsoon season, you must have seen that the officials from the government, they spray kerosene on stagnant water. So what happens is the stagnant water has surface tension in it, and due to this surface tension, the mosquitoes are able to lay their eggs on it. So the mosquito eggs will perish or will die if they get drowned in water. So when they spray the kerosene over the water, the kerosene acts as a surfactant. It reduces the surface tension and the mosquito eggs drown in the water and they die. So here the lysine does the same thing. It reduces the surface tension so that the alveoli don't collapse. The alveoli might collapse if the surface tension increases. So this enzyme basically diffuses the surface tension. Okay, what else do we have? Now if we look into an alveolar sac, okay, this alveoli is basically lined with simple squamous epithelium. The alveoli is lined with simple squamous epithelium, and around the alveoli we will have a capillary. This capillary wall is also lined with a single layer of simple squamous epithelium. So this is known as the capithelial endothelium, and this simple squamous epithelium is known as the alveolar epithelium. So these combined way make the respiratory membrane. So what is the respiratory membrane made up of? The alveolar epithelium, which is basically a single layer of alveolar epithelium, because the gaseous exchange takes place through this. The capillaries will carry the oxygen and the nutrients to the cells and so on and so forth. So respiratory membrane is made up of the alveolar epithelium, then we have the capillary endothelium and the interstitial fluid. So there is an interstitial fluid in between which basically takes care of this. So this is how the respiratory membrane will look like. Okay, made up of the alveolar epithelium, again a single layer of epithelium cells, squamous epithelium, capillary endothelium, which is again a single layer of squamous epithelium, and there is some interstitial fluid in between them. So this is how the entire bronchiole and entire structure will, this entire thing this bronchiole and the entire structure is collectively known as the lobule. So this bronchiole and their entire structure is collectively known as the lobule. Okay. Alright people, so we will talk about a little more about how the breathing and respiration takes place. Okay, so little diagrammatic representation of how the larynx, this is basically the larynx, and we have these cartilages which are in the form of rings. These cartilages extend and they actually move into the lung. We have seen in the previous slides that the lung is like a triangular structure with the tip of the triangle on the top and the base on the lower side. Okay, so this is basically the left and the right bronchi. The left and right bronchi are little different. The left bronchi is narrower and longer and more horizontal, and the right bronchi is more vertical and is broader as well. Okay, so these enter their respective lungs, and then the branching and rebranching of takes place, and then we have the alveoli located here. So if we look into it, this is how the epiglottis would basically appear. So this is the base of the tongue, and these are the vocal cords, basically the epiglottis and the vocal cords. This is basically the glottis. So the larynx as viewed from above, this is basically the larynx as viewed from above, and we have these alveolar duct. If you look into it, this is the alveolar duct. We have the alveoli here. These are the alveoli. This is the terminal bronchiole. This is the terminal bronchiole and how it branches out. So this is the respiratory bronchiole. Okay, so now we will understand the process in detail. So inhalation is basically a process in which the air comes in. Now, in order to understand the mechanism of breathing in humans takes place in two steps. One is the inhalation process and the other one is the exhalation process. Inhalation in scientific terms is known as inspiration, and exhalation is known as expiration. Inhalation is an active process. Why is it an active process? Because there is muscle contraction that happens, and any kind of muscle contraction in our body will have a requirement of ATP. So muscle contraction cannot take place without ATP getting involved. That's the reason it is known as an active process. Whereas expiration is a passive process. The muscles relax, so no ATP here is required. It is a passive process. It will happen on its own. Okay. So what are the muscles which actually help in inhalation or inspiration? We have the diaphragm, obviously the diaphragm. So the external intercostal muscles, and then we have external intercostal muscles. So in the structure of lungs, there is almost negligible muscles present there. Okay, there is hardly any kind of muscles which are present in lungs. So almost negligible muscular region, contrary to the heart, which is highly muscular. Okay, so hence we will require external muscles are always a requirement. We will always require an external muscle because we have an active process taking place. Okay, so lungs are tightly packed in the thoracic cavity. They are tightly packed and do not have their muscular structure. So contraction has to be how will this contraction come in? We will need external intercostal muscles and the diaphragm for the contraction of the lungs. And until unless the contraction happens, the expansion also will not happen. Okay. Okay, so now we are going to understand the mechanism of breathing wherein the contraction of certain muscles takes place. So as we have seen in the lungs, there is no muscles that are present, almost negligible muscle masses there. So the lungs have to depend on two types of muscles for contraction and expansion. Obviously, the contraction and expansion is something that is required for both inhalation and exhalation of air. So the two muscles which help in the contraction are diaphragm and the intercostal muscles. So we are going to understand how the coordination of this entire muscular structure takes place. Okay, so in the thoracic cavity, on the sides of the ribs and on the lower portion, we have the diaphragm. So diaphragm is on the lower portion of our lungs, and this basically separates the thoracic cavity from the abdominal region. So it's a muscular region, highly muscular, and this basically separates. So these are the two lungs that we have. Okay, there is a vertebral column here, and this diaphragm separates the thoracic cavity from the abdominal portion. Okay, so it separates the. So generally it is dome shaped. It's like this. Okay, it's like this. This is basically dome shaped. So the diaphragm is like a dome shaped structure. Okay, now what happens is the backbone is on the dorsal side. The muscles from the peripheral side go. Now look at this diaphragm. Now these muscles basically go from the peripheral portion to the ribs. We all know that we have ribs. Okay, so this is like the, these are like the muscles which go from the peripheral portion to the ribs. All along the diaphragm muscles are attached to the rib cage. All of them are attached to the rib cage. So the backbone is on the dorsal side. The muscles from the peripheral side, all along the diaphragm muscles, are attached to the rib cage. Now these muscles are also known as phrenic or radial muscles, and they are attached to the peripheral part of the rib cage. So they are attached to the peripheral part of the rib cage. These are also known as phrenic or radial muscles attached to the peripheral part of the rib cage. Okay, so in this case we have. So what happens is we'll understand the mechanism. First, let's understand there's another set of muscles which are known as intercostal muscles. Now these intercostal muscles are present in between the rib. We all know that we have basically 12 pairs. So this is basically, let's say, the rib cage, and these are the ribs, and in between them the intercostal. So these are known as external intercostal muscles. Okay, they are also known as external intercostal muscles. So in between the 12 pairs of ribs, okay, there are 12 pairs of ribs, so there are 11 pairs of external intercostal muscles. We have 12 pairs of ribs which are protecting both our lungs, and in between these 12 pairs of ribs we have basically 11 pairs of external intercostal muscles. Okay, now when the contraction happens, contraction, so what exactly happens during contraction or inhalation or inspiration? It's an active process which will involve contraction of muscle and which will also involve ATPs. Okay, so the thoracic cavity is basically tight compartment. The thoracic cavity, if you look into it, is a tight compartment. When radial muscles contract, so these radial muscles basically they contract, the diaphragm becomes flat. So as I said, the diaphragm is like a dome shaped structure. When the radial muscles are contracting, okay, the radial muscles or the phrenic muscles are contracting, so what will happen? If these muscles will pull the diaphragm, and the diaphragm will become flat. Okay, so this will become flat. The radial muscles contract, the diaphragm becomes flat, and the volume of the thoracic cavity will increase. Obviously it was dome shaped. The moment it becomes flat, it becomes broad, the volume of the thoracic cavity increases. Okay, and the intercostal muscles, what do? The intercostal muscles basically are attached to the rib cage of each of the bones. They move up and out, so the chest becomes broader. So this is basically contraction, and this also will result in the increase in volume of the thoracic cavity. So with the assistance of these two types of muscles, that is the intercostal muscles and the muscles which are attached to the diaphragm, which are also known as the radial muscles or phrenic muscles, there is an increase in volume of the thoracic cavity produced. Okay, okay, so we have here so we were trying to understand how the contraction and expansion basically takes place, and in this process, okay, contraction, we have seen what are the muscles which are basically involved. We have the radial muscles which are attached from the diaphragm to the rib cage, and within the rib cage itself we have muscles which are also known as external intercostal muscles. So these are the muscles. The external intercostal muscles increase the volume of the rib cage, and these muscles, which are basically the radial muscles or Phrenic muscles, they basically pull the diaphragm. So the diaphragm is naturally dome shaped, but when it's pulled, the volume basically increases. When the volume increases, obviously the pressure inside decreases. So we'll see how this works. So the contraction of the diaphragm and the intercostal muscles both increase the volume of the thoracic cavity. Obviously the diaphragm is dome shaped, but being pulled by the radial muscles, it decreases. It becomes flat. So the volume of the thoracic cavity increases, and in addition to the diaphragm moving down, there is the rib cage which are moving up and out. The rib cage is basically moving up and out. Why? Because of the intercostal muscles which are present in between the rib cage. So when volume decreases, pressure, when volume increases, pressure would decrease. This pressure inside the lungs decreases by about 2 to 6 millimeter of mercury. 2 to 6 millimeter of mercury as compared to the atmospheric pressure. This will decrease by this amount. Okay. So negative pressure is generated inside, and hence air moves from higher to lower pressure. There is a suction pressure which is created. So the air basically moves from higher to lower pressure. And we would require ATP in this process. In the process of exhalation, so as we know that inhalation is an active process because it involves muscle contraction. What are the muscles which are basically getting contracted? The intercostal muscles and the radial muscles, which are attached to the periphery of the diaphragm. Okay, so these two muscles basically contract. So the radial muscles now both the muscles will relax. Okay, so relax, and the rib cage is coming back to its normal position. So the diaphragm again becomes dome shaped. The diaphragm again becomes dome shaped. The volume of the thoracic cavity will now decrease. Okay, so the entire volume decreases, and hence the pressure would increase. The volume of the thoracic cavity decreases, and hence the pressure would increase. The air is going to move out now. Okay, the air will move out. So in exhalation, the muscles relax. So why is the air going to move out? Because the pressure inside the thoracic cavity becomes more than the outside pressure. So the air moves out. This pretty much explains the process of normal breathing. There is something called as forceful breathing, and we will understand the context of forceful breathing in the next slide. But here we have to consider what basically is normal breathing. Okay.